Good morning, church. Welcome to the Lighthouse. Should we stand together as we begin our time of worship? Dear Jesus, we bless your name, God. You're welcome in this place. We say that in all things you have the first place. We say that in everything you have preeminence. Turn our eyes to you, God. Lover of our soul, captain of our lives. We exalt your name, God. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. Yes, Jesus. Yeah. Okay, let's praise God. Let's worship Him.
Never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand.
Let's sing it together.
The moment that I wake till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
All my life you have been so, so.
of the goodness of God. Oh, my life, all my life, you have been faithful. Oh, this is our song today.
All my life,
you have been so,
so good.
With every breath,
with every
breath, I am able.
Oh, I will sing of the goodness.
One more time, all my life you've been faithful. Let's sing it like we mean it.
All my life you have been faithful.
This is our song today.
And all my life you have been so, so good.
With every breath,
with every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Jesus, for your goodness. We'd like to introduce a new song to you. It's called God of Revival. Psalm 85, the psalmist was saying to God, God, would you revive us, God, so that we could rejoice in you? So as we sing this song, just look at the words, try and engage as best as you can, even if it's a new song. But more importantly, let's sing this as a prayer. Let's sing this in faith. Let's sing it with a degree of conviction. That God revive us. Search our hearts, search our city. And bring alive the things that may seem dead, God. Darkest night, you can light it up, you can light it up, oh God of revival, let hope arise, death is overcome, you've already won, oh God of revival, the darkest night,
darkest night, you can light it up.
Darkest night, you can light.
every stronghold will crumble. I hear the chains hit the ground. God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Oh, oh, oh. Pour it out on us, pour it out on us. Revive us so we may revive us so we may rejoice in you, God. No mountains you can't move, all things are possible. There's no broken body you can raise, no soul that you can save, all things are possible. Let's sing that together again. There's no prison wall you can break through, no mountains you can move, all things are possible in you, Jesus. There's no broken body you can raise, no soul that you can save, all things are possible.
The glory, you are worthy.
someone all over this room. Why don't we just begin to release our own sound? Why don't we just begin to release our own declaration? He is a holy God, and He is the one we've come to worship this morning. Come on, we don't need the band to release this sound. It has to come from the depths of our hearts. Wherever you may be right now, why don't you just begin to release the sound? Release the sound. It's not unto man, it's unto the one who is holy, unto the one who is worthy, unto the one who is mighty. Church, release the sound, release the sound. You know, church, this is such a special moment. And it's so easy for me to run, but I want to grab you and gather you and drag you with me into this moment of worship. You know, some of us have probably had such a tough week. Some of us right now are probably looking at walls of Jericho in front of us and saying, Lord, I want to worship, but there's this thing in front of me. There's this thing in front of me. Can I encourage you in this moment? If that is you, release your sound, because your praise is attached to your breakthrough. Just the way they began to worship and release the sound and the walls of Jericho began to fall, your praise is attached to your breakthrough this morning. Some of us might be in this camp, but Hebrews 12 verse 1 says that since we are gathered by such a great cloud of witnesses, since we are gathered, let us throw off everything that hinders, everything that easily entangles. Let us run this race with perseverance. And I love this part. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus. Why? Because He is the author and perfecter of our faith. Church, when we begin to fix our eyes on Jesus, we begin to realize He is holy, He is worthy of our praise, and that there's nothing that will hold me back from praising my King this morning. Come on, church, why don't you just begin to release your own sound in this place? Why don't you just begin to release the sound in this place? Release the sound in this place. It's not to man, it's to the King of Kings, it's to the Lord of Lords, the one who is worthy of our praise, the one who is worthy of all the glory. Let's exalt Him. Let's exalt Him all around this room. Let's exalt Him. Oh, we worship You, Lord. We worship You, Lord. None like You, King of Glory. None like You. None like You. Lord, wherever we may find ourselves this morning, Lord, whatever the week may have looked like, whatever the solutions we're waiting on You for, whatever the breakthrough that we're expecting may be, in this place, oh God, we say we will not stay silent, but we will cry out. We will cry out unto You, for You are worthy. You are so worthy. Not because of the things that You do for us, just simply who You are. Just simply who You are. We behold You, oh God, we behold You. seated in the highest of highest. The one that cannot be dethroned. The one that conquered all. We bless your name in this place, for you are so worthy. We're here for you and you alone. Holy, holy, holy. Lord, may your words be so true in this service today that you inhabit the praises of your people. So, presence of God, we welcome you in this place. We welcome you in this place. Take your rightful place in this house, oh God. And Lord, above all, that you will receive all the honor, all the glory, all the adoration. Receive it all. It's all yours. 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 Not mine. No one else's. Just you. Just you. Just you. Just you. Thank you for this moment, and we bless your name. In Jesus' name we pray, church. Come on, church, why don't you just help me praise the Lord this morning, for he is so worthy. There's none like him, none that will ever be. He is the reason we come together to worship, for he is holy, he is worthy, he is mighty. I will give him all the praise and all the glory. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Well, church, welcome. Welcome to our 11 a.m. service. Thank you for joining with us, whether you're in person or you're joining online. You are welcome. And church, before you sit down, may I encourage you to say hi to your neighbor. Say hi to somebody next to you. Let them know you're happy to see them. You're welcome also online. If you could maybe put something in the comment section, let somebody know that you are there and you are happy to see them online. So good to see all of you guys this morning. You are welcome. Also online, you are so, so welcome. But before we go any further, we have a tradition that I dearly love here at the Lighthouse, that we want to create space to just welcome. Amen. Just checking we're all awake. Just to welcome anybody who maybe it's your first time worshiping with us this morning. Maybe you've never been here at the Lighthouse, and this is your first time here in the building, here at the center, here in this church. We would love to say hi to you, and what we'd love for you to do is to just raise your hand up, and we would love to just welcome you. If that is you, if it is your first time worshiping with us this morning, why don't you just shoot your hand up? Church, why don't we welcome our family. Also online, if that is you, please put something in the comments. Say, let them know you are there. But if you're in the building, please, after the service, don't rush off. We would love to say hi to you. Our welcome team would love to just get to know you a little bit better. Get to know your name. We love names here. Get to know who you are. So if that is you and you're in the house, you're here in person, as you walk out the double doors right at the back, if you go to your left side, you'll be able to see some couches with some friendly faces, which is our welcome area, and love to just offer you a drink of your choice, say hi to you, and get to know you a little bit better. Just a couple of announcements from me before we go to the infomercials. Firstly, is that our pastor, lead pastor, Pastor Paul, is still in India. He's been there for just a bit, coming up to 2 weeks, and I was talking to him earlier this week, and he was just encouraging and saying that, you know, he's been going to India for so many years, but yet he doesn't ever get shocked by what God is doing, that God is always on the move. So that's always amazing to hear, that actually church is not just these four walls, but we get to be and partner with Christ all around the world. So whilst he's in India, and he'll be returning back later this week, please, may I encourage you to keep him in your prayers. Pray for him. Pray for safe travels back. Pray that even the time that he has left in India, that God will just do extraordinary stuff. So I'd encourage you to keep Pastor Paul in your prayers. And also, every single month we have something called First Fruit, which is our giving above and beyond our tithes and offerings, that is a designated giving. And this month we heard a report of Jubilee Holidays and the incredible stuff that they were doing and they're still doing, and we want to support them. We want to get behind them. For those who missed it, Jubilee Holidays actually is a charity that has been led by Mick and Sarah and the team, that they gather families that might not potentially be able to ever be able to go on a holiday, but they gather them, go on holiday with them, and share a week of joy, fun, laughter, and Christ-centered love with them. And this year, they are actually looking at doing 3 weeks, with each week looking around 12 families. So we want to get behind them. We want to support what they're doing. So our First Fruit this month is still going to be going towards that. And if you didn't get a chance to give, or you'd still want to give, please, you can do that through the envelopes. Just designate your giving towards Jubilee Holidays, or online, also do the same. Or if both of those options sound like a maze, that's also okay. Please come and see me. I'd love to assist you and make it easier for you to support the things that they're doing. That's it from me. If we can go to infomercials at the back. Bless you guys.
Hey church, and welcome to The Lighthouse. My name's Eliana and this is Church Needs. First up, for all the young adults ages 18 to 30, we've got some exciting news for you guys. As some of you may know, we are currently doing after service meals. And on Sunday 21st of April, after our 2 p.m. service, we'll be having yet another after service meal, and this time it will be led by Echoes M Group. Guys, it is an amazing way for you to build community. The theme will be Olympics, there'll be food provided, and I heard there might be a prize at the end. So guys, come and join. It's only £5, food included. Come. Hope to see you there. Are you wanting to connect with people outside of just a Sunday service? Are you trying to build relationships or even go deeper in your walk with God whilst fellowshipping with others? If so, why don't you join one of our Connect groups? We have got so many that you can get involved in. We have got youth group for ages 11 to 17. We have got M groups for ages 18 to 30. And we have got C groups for ages 30 plus. You know, on our website, there's so much information on how you can get involved, what days they are on, and where they are at. There is no reason for you guys to not get involved. We are not meant to do this life alone. So come and join. And if you do have any more questions or would like any more information, you can speak to any of the team within the welcome table or the ones that have got a lanyard. And lastly, we have got something special for you guys. Lighthouse The Voice is back.
It's not Lighthouse The Voice.
Oh.
My beloved is the most beautiful amongst thousands and thousands.
You have got talent.
Oh, thanks.
No, I'm being dead serious. You've got talent. Please tell me you signed up to Lighthouse Got Talent.
No, what's that?
On the 7th of April, Riot will be taking over our two. And that's all for church news this week. If you'd like to stay updated.
Lighthouse Got Talent. A time where you can showcase your rapping skills, your juggling skills, your guitar skills, whatever it is that you'd like to showcase to us. Please sign up now. Now the date is the 18th of May. It starts at 7 p.m. sharp. Could I please ask you to get your tickets on time? Because it's at £5 for early birds. If not, £8 at the door. Get them early. And there are also family discounts. So please, come and show support to your fellow Lighthouse members and cheer them on. Thank you.
So, are you in?
Yeah, I'll go sign up now.
Oh, yeah, yeah, chill. You don't see the influencers on right now.
Oh.
And that is all for church news this week. If you'd like to stay updated with things going on here at The Lighthouse, you can do so by following us on our socials or by visiting our website. We're now going to enter a time of worship through our giving. So if you came prepared to give today, you can do so by following the steps on the screen, by scanning the QR code, or through the envelopes that are on your seat where you're able to place them in the baskets at the front during the last song. Have a blessed Sunday.
That's great. Just before we send Life Force out, we actually have a child dedication this morning. And so we're going to dedicate Anaya Nakai Zinyama. So I would love to invite David and Charmaine and the family to please come forward as we get ready to dedicate Anaya. Can we just give them a round of applause as they come forward? Welcome all friends, family, which is a great occasion. Yeah, everyone, please come forward. You know, we always say here at the Lighthouse, this is a very special moment here. Hey, a special moment here where we get to dedicate our children to the Lord. We know children, as Psalms 127 says, they're a heritage and a reward from Him. And so this is a special honor and privilege. And we always say this, as important as this moment is, this is just one of the many steps to help raise Anaya and dedicate her to the Lord, where we know David and Charmaine have the great privilege, but also everyone here on the stage, friends, family, have the privilege of helping to raise Anaya, getting her in the house of the Lord and also raising her up. We know Proverbs 22:6 says, train your child in the ways of the Lord, and when they're older, they will not depart. And so this is really what we're going to pray for. And so can you join with me as we pray? First, before we pray for Anaya, can you join me as we pray for David and Charmaine and the family for wisdom, discernment of how to raise Anaya? And also we're going to pray for David and Charmaine's marriage. So if you can just stretch out your hands as we pray for these guys. But dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for today and we thank you for this moment. As David and Charmaine are bringing Anaya before you with friends and family here, Lord, and we just pray, Lord God, I pray for wisdom and discernment to raise up Anaya, train her in the ways of the Lord. I pray, Lord God, even when things are difficult, maybe even when they're confused, Lord, they will still hold firm to the truth of your word, Lord God. And no matter what she is taught in school, no matter what she is taught around, Lord God, they will build a foundation based on your word, based in your presence, Lord God, that we're wherever Anaya goes, Lord God, whether she's in school, university, and as she gets older, God, everything that she was taught, everything that she was trained, Lord God, will be the foundation, Lord God, that she will not depart. We also pray for David and Charmaine's marriage, Lord God. I pray for strength, Lord God. Lord God, as they raise up, Lord God, Anaya, Lord God, there will be strength between the two of them, Lord God. And as they seek you, Lord God, you will give them the wisdom, Lord, strength for their marriage, but wisdom to raise up Anaya in the ways of the Lord. We pray for friends and family as well. They will be a covering. They will be a support, God. Every time David and Charmaine are weak, Lord God, they will be strong, supporting David and Charmaine as they raise up Anaya. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Now we're going to pray for Anaya. I love this. Anaya in Hebrew means, it actually has two meanings. Number one, God answers, but also the answer of God. And what we're going to pray is that she will be a blessing, an answer from God to her family, but also she will be an answer to God. It reminds me of the prophet Samuel, that he was an answer to God being a prophet. So we're going to pray that she will be a woman who answers the prayers of God. So do you want to try? Do you think she's going to? Yeah, we're going to try. Hannah, do you mind just holding the mic? We're going to try. We'll see. That's great. If you mind just stretching your hand as we pray for Anaya. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray for Anaya. Thank you, Lord, that she is an answer to prayer. Lord God, I pray she'll continue to be an answer, a prayer, a blessing to her parents. But also she, God, will answer your prayer. She'll be a woman who knows how to enter into the heavenly courts to answer the needs and the prayers of God. She will be a warrior, Lord God, all the days of her life, Lord God. She will continue to seek your face, Lord God. Know what is on your heart and pray the prayers of God. So we pray for Anaya. We speak these words over your life. Anaya, we say you will be the head and not the tail. You will be above and not beneath. You will be the lender, not the borrower. And Lord, we pray for Anaya, Lord God. Keep your face on her, Lord God. Keep your hands upon her, Lord God. She will be a blessing and she will be blessed all the days of her life. So we thank you. We pray, God, heaven will record this moment as we have dedicated her to you. She will also in due time dedicate her life to you, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. That is great. Can we just give it up for David, Charmaine, and I and the family? Thank you so much. Just as we get ready to go into worship, I wonder if you can play the Light Force video. Thank you.
Hey, kids. Hey, you. Before we get back into the worship, it's time for Light Force and for you. So go to the back of the church and someone will lead you upstairs.
Should we stand together as Light Force kids and parents are going out.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on the cursed tree. His body bowed and drenched in tears, they laid him down.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord. is worthy of all of the praise. He is worthy of all of our adoration. Forever and ever, we will give you praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We have forever and ever to praise him. We haven't got forever and ever in this service, so take your seats. Thank you, band. Good to see you this morning. A few weeks ago, I was asked to be in the music band for Balaji and Mwaka's wedding. And you know, the way that I'm used to in these things, you decide what songs you're going to do, what key everything's going to be in, you practice together, and then you do what you said you were going to do. It's kind of, you know, straightforward and simple. So anyway, I get the schedule, and they said, all right, we're going to start with this song, and while the bridal party is coming in, it's going to be an instrumental, we're going to do a verse and a chorus, and then there'll be this song, and that'll be a verse and a chorus, and then there'll be a hymn later, and so on and so on. So I made sure I knew all of the songs, checked I got the right keys, and we had to practice together. And in the practice, a couple of things changed. So we weren't doing the first song, but we were doing the second song. And when the bridal party got halfway down the aisle, then the singer would begin with this. So that's fine, no problem. So we get to the wedding day, and I arrive there on time. Don't know why I did that. Seriously, this is an African wedding. I arrive there, there's like a couple of cleaners just kind of mopping up from the night before or whatever, and people setting chairs out. So, okay, so it goes on. And about 30 minutes after the wedding was supposed to start, there's still people drifting in here and there. Somebody comes up to the band and says, do you mind just kind of playing something as people are coming in? So, all right, that wasn't part of the original plan, but hey, no problem. So the band starts off playing something. I don't know what it was. They all knew what it was. So I'm just kind of playing along and going with it. And then we get the signal that the wedding party is coming in. So I think, okay, this is the first song. This is the instrumental while the bridal party are entering. So I get the eye off the keyboard player and I start playing. And then the keyboard player is looking at me and he's going. And I think, okay, have I missed something? And then I see that the keyboard player look at the bass player and the bass player looks at the drummer. And there's this kind of unspoken communication going on between them. And suddenly then the singer comes in with a completely different song that we never rehearsed, but they're all fine with it. They're all, you know, it's smooth, it's professional. These guys can play, and I'm like, ooh, this is okay, fine. So I just kind of tried to play along and pretend to look as if I knew what I was doing, you know, and then it went. It's that somehow transitioned seamlessly into another song that we'd never practiced. And then that moved on to a song that we had practiced, but not where we said it was going to be. And then there was going to be this hymn later on, which again, we'd practiced, and all of the words were in the printed order of service. Never happened. Never sung anything of that hymn. I don't know what happened. We did sing something else. I can't exactly remember when it's all a bit of a blur by this time. But you know, it was great, and I just, you know, as I say, pretended to look as if I knew what I was doing, and afterwards I texted the band. I said, it was great playing with you guys. You were amazing. I really learned something. I said, I learned that the way that you do things, the plan is that there is no plan. And I got some little smiley emojis back. And a couple of days later, I was talking to one of the singers who's from our church, and she said, I saw your text. She says, you got the culture. The title of my message today is, you got the culture. You got the culture. You know, culture is great. Culture is fine. That's just one example of a church music culture. And it's fine, it works. It's a way of doing things. Or it worked for them. I have no idea what I was doing. But what I want to say is, don't confuse culture with faith. Don't ever mistake church culture for the reality of your relationship with God. Just because you've got the culture doesn't mean that you're living your life right with the Lord. See, we can have a church culture where if you raise your hands in worship and if you can say praise the Lord, then okay, you must be good. You're one of us. You're a bona fide Christian. You must be right with the Lord. And that's your ticket in. You're there. But you know, you can praise the Lord. Oh, my. You can do that as much as you want. And that's great, and there's nothing wrong with that. But please don't think that that makes you a Christian. The culture is not it. The culture is just the wrapping, not the package. The wrapping may look right, but what is inside is what counts. You know, you've grown up in church and you know Christian language. Hallelujah, praise the Lord, brother, in Jesus' name, amen. You've got the lingo, you've got the jargon. You know, there was a preacher a few decades ago now who actually banned these phrases from his church. Not because there's anything wrong with them, but because he saw that that language, that culture, had become actually a mask for the reality of what was going on. You know, it used to be so common, maybe, I don't know, 30 years ago, when you went to church, everybody in the church, you called them brother or sister. Hello, brother, how are you? It's changed into bro now. Oh, it's changed into bruh now, hasn't it? But what we called each other brother, we called each other sister. Honestly, why? Half the time it's because we couldn't remember the name. And you know, how many times has somebody asked you, how are you? And you say, I'm good, thanks. And you're not at all. You're not at all. You're going through hell. There's all sorts of stuff going wrong. But that's the culture. You say it, but it's not the reality. And so what I'm saying is you can worship the Lord and have a disobedient heart. If you're aware of some of the things that are coming up in the news, things coming to light about prominent, reputable, long-standing Christian leaders, and we're finding out all sorts of stuff about these people. I'm not going to name names, but you'll know who I'm talking about if you're aware of these things. You will understand that you can flourish in the culture and yet be way out of line with God. I want to take us to a Bible passage. This is King Saul. And God had told Saul to, early in his reign, God had told him to destroy the Amalekites. So Samuel said to Saul, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I will punish the Amalekites for what they did to Israel when they waylaid them as they came up from Egypt. Now go, attack the Amalekites. Do not spare them. Totally destroy all that belongs to them. And Saul did. He went and he did it, but not entirely. Verse 7, then Saul attacked the Amalekites all the way from Havilah to Shur. All the people he totally destroyed with the sword. But he spared Agag, the king of the Amalekites, and the best of the sheep and the cattle. Everything that was good, these they were unwilling to destroy completely. He destroyed the Amalekites, but he spared the king and he spared the best of their animals. That's called partial obedience. It's obedience, but it's partial obedience. Some of us are good at that. There's plenty of us doing that right now. Partial obedience, obeying the Lord, just not in everything. Following the Lord, except in this matter. So Saul knows that he has been partially obedient. But instead of confessing it to Samuel, he covers it up with Christian talk. He covers it up with the culture. Go to the next slide. When Samuel approached him, Saul said, "The Lord bless you." He brought in the culture straight away. "Ooh, you've got the culture, Saul." He's walking in disobedience. He's out of line with God and he knows it, but he covers it with spiritual talk. "Samuel, brother, the Lord bless you and keep you." He's putting on this cover, and he follows that up with a partial truth to cover up his partial obedience. "I have carried out the Lord's instructions." No, you've carried out some of the Lord's instructions. And Samuel is not fooled, because he can hear sheep bleating and cows mooing. And he says, "Well, that doesn't sound like obedience." Disobedience has a sound. It carries something. You know something's not right. Disobedience produces its own fruit and its own consequences. We see the next consequence for Saul in the following chapter, in chapter 16, verse 14. It says, "The Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul." That's what happens when you're disobedient or partially obedient. God's Spirit left him. He no longer had that rapport, that fellowship with the Holy Spirit. He was no longer hearing the voice of God. You can cover it up with your Christian culture, but the reality is the Holy Spirit has left. And then the next consequence, it says, "And an evil spirit began to torment him." When God's Spirit leaves, other things began to take over. Trouble arrives. There will be things that torment you. You'll lose your peace and you won't get it back until you put it right. You know, this can happen on all sorts of levels, big things and small things. It can happen on a small scale. Maybe, you know, I upset my wife or one of my kids because I talked harshly with them, and now I don't feel good in my spirit. I'm unsettled. I've lost my peace. I'm troubled. And this thought torments me. Why did he do that? Why did he say that way? Go and put it right. And when you put it right, God's peace returns. The fellowship of the Holy Spirit returns. The presence of God returns. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Ever been in that situation? Yeah? So the Spirit of God departed from Saul. But incredibly, he kept his kingship. He remained king for about 15 more years after that. That's incredible. That's amazing. He kept the culture. He kept up the appearance. He kept his reputation as king. He did everything that a king would do. But he'd lost the reality. God says, "You're not king anymore." When you are walking in partial obedience or in disobedience as a Christian, you've usually got a line of thought to justify your disobedience. So when Samuel says to Saul, "So what's this bleating of sheep in my ears?" Look at Saul's reply, verse 15. First, he says, "The soldiers brought them from the Amalekites." Not my fault. It was somebody else. He blames others. And then he says, "They spared the best of the sheep and the cattle to sacrifice to the Lord your God." So this is two excuses now, which don't really tally up with one another. One, he's blaming them. He says, "Well, it wasn't me." But then he said, "Well, they had a good reason to do it, because it was for sacrifice. God loves sacrifice. And we need animals for sacrifice every morning. That there's an offering every evening. There's an offering. There's sin offerings, trespass offerings, guilt offerings, burnt offerings, sin offerings. You name it. We need animals. And here's a load of good animals. This is perfect." It doesn't make sense to destroy them. You know, how many times has God told you to do something and it doesn't make sense? It's not reasonable. But we are so good at finding justification for our disobedience by looking at reason. We're good at finding reasons to justify disobedience. Well, I know what God says about sex and outside of marriage, but in this day and age, come on. Or, well, we know we're going to get married anyway, so it seems reasonable to just be living together now? Or, God told me to do this, but I just can't. In my current circumstances, I can't do that. I don't think it's reasonable for me to have to do that. It doesn't make sense. I don't think God would expect me to. How many times have you heard that? Maybe in your own head. I don't think God would expect me to. We're justifying disobedience or partial obedience. So Samuel doesn't buy these excuses from Saul. Just go to the next slide. He says, you've got the right words, you've got the culture, but you've not got obedience. You're rebellious, you won't submit, you won't receive orders. And Samuel says this to him in verse 23, because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected you from being king. Ooh. So now it hits home. This is the consequences. You can't be king anymore. And look how immediately Saul changes his tone. I have sinned. Now he's confessing. Before he was justifying it. No, nothing wrong with what they did. It was the soldiers and it was the sacrifice. Now I have sinned. He gets scared now because his kingship is at stake, which means his pride, his reputation, his honor. So now he's willing to bargain with Samuel. He's willing to confess that he's wrong privately to Samuel in order to save face and keep his reputation and honor in public. Keeping up the appearance was worth it. Okay, let's just keep this hush-hush and carry on as normal. Some people will put honor before anything. Saul's value system was not God's value system. What mattered most to Saul was his reputation, his honor, looking good to other people, being respected by others. He wasn't too worried about whether he was disobedient or obedient. That wasn't high up on his value system, but honor, that mattered. Being shamed or disgraced in front of others, that would be the ultimate humiliation. That's a warped value system. That's a warped value system, and that tells me that Saul lacked the fear of the Lord. He feared people. And he tells us that in verse 24. He says, I was afraid of the men, so I gave in to them. He's being honest now. He feared people, but he didn't fear the Lord. He would rather keep his honor in front of people on this earth, and he'd trade that for facing God and facing judgment and the consequences of that. That's a crazy man. That's a crazy guy. But that's what happens when you put honor before everything else. So he admits he's wrong. He says, I've sinned. But then he says, verse 25, now I beg you, forgive my sin and come back with me so that I may worship the Lord. You know what he's saying here? He's saying, Samuel, please, can we just overlook this little episode and just move on? And Samuel says to him, no, I'm not going back with you. But Saul doesn't give up. Verse 30, Saul replied, I have sinned, but please honor me before the elders of my people and before Israel. Come back with me that I may worship the Lord your God. Do you notice now it's changed to the Lord your God? What happened to the Lord my God? See, Samuel knows that Saul knows that he's wrong. He knows that he's out of fellowship. He knows he's out of line. So it's the Lord your God. He says, but I want to keep in this culture. I want to keep my reputation. I don't want to lose my pride. I don't want to be disgraced. I don't want to be ashamed. I might not have my God anymore, but at least I can keep up the appearance and go and worship. Let me carry on with the culture. I've messed up, but let's keep that between us. And so verse 31, this is amazing. So Samuel went back with Saul. And Saul worshipped the Lord. Look at that. He did it. Politics won. Samuel said he wouldn't go back. I will not go back with you. But somehow in the end, he gave in. Saul got his way. He kept up appearances for 15 years. He kept on doing all of the kingy things that kings do. All of the religious, keeping the sacrifices and the festivals and everything. All of the appearance was there, but the reality behind it all was the reality of disobedience and that he'd lost the kingship. You can keep up appearances and maintain the culture and keep on coming to church and do the worship and be a great prayer and everything else and be covering up the fact that your life is out of line with God. There's something that's not right and you've not dealt with it. You can worship fervently and passionately and wholeheartedly while you're living in disobedience. And here's how some people think. My worship is my repentance. I cover my sin with my worship. I know I've done wrong, but I can make up for it by coming to the house of God and worshiping the Lord. My worship is my atonement. But let me tell you that the only thing that can make atonement for sin is the blood of Jesus. The only thing that can cleanse us from sin is the blood of Jesus. The only thing that can cover sin is the blood of Jesus. And the blood of Jesus is only available to people who repent of disobedience and choose obedience. Then the way is open to you to come back into fellowship, to be restored into fellowship with God. If you're worshiping your Lord, but you're disobedient or partially obedient, then you're not truly worshiping. And he's not truly your Lord. If you're praying to God, but you're living in disobedience, your prayers may sound wonderful, but they're not getting past the ceiling. The reality is you've got the culture, but you're missing the fear of the Lord, and you need a real encounter with God. Yeah, can I call the band up, please? The first thing that happens when you encounter the Lord is conviction. Last week, Pastor Jesse was preaching on Isaiah, and we looked at that passage where Isaiah sees the Lord. And Isaiah is a Jew. He's a God-fearing Jew. He's a prophet. He knows God. He's been called by God. He knows the culture inside out. God has already spoken to him. There's been five chapters of prophecy before chapter 6, and God has spoken to him, and Isaiah has delivered that word from the Lord. But in chapter 6, he encounters God in a new way, and the immediate result of that encounter is conviction. Conviction comes upon him. I don't know what he felt that he'd done wrong, But somehow in the light of that encounter with God, he said, woe is me. I'm doomed. For I'm a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. Conviction. Look at Peter. Peter, again, was a God-fearing Jew. He was steeped in the culture of Israel. He was following God. But when he sees Jesus do the miracle of the 5,000, he'd left all to follow Jesus. But he sees this miracle and he realizes a conviction comes upon him. He suddenly realizes, it says, he fell at Jesus' feet and he said, go away from me, Lord. I'm a sinful man. A strong conviction came over him. The first fruit of an encounter with God is conviction. Some of us today, we need an encounter with God to break us out of our culture, to break us out of our disobedience or our partial obedience to break us out of our justifications and excuses for the sins that we've learned to be comfortable with. For the call to obedience that we've ignored and learned to turn a blind eye to and push it under the carpet and forget about it and carry on with our culture, carry on with coming to church, carry on with being in the prayer meeting, carry on with doing the worship. I'm not going to make any altar call this morning, but I do want to ask if there is anybody here this morning and you know today that you need to commit your life to God. You need to make a dedication of yourself to God. You need to make that step today. If that is you, and you know when I'm talking to you, you know that it's you, just please put your hand up for me. Just quickly put your hand up so that I can see who you are. Thank you. Anybody else? You know that this is the day. Thank you. I see your hand. This is the time that you've got to give your life to God. You've got to make that commitment. You've got to put yourself right. That way is open for you today. Thank you. For those who put your hands up, if you want to come and meet with me at the end of this service, we've got a place that you can go and people want to pray with you and give you some material that will help you on your journey into life. And for the rest of us this morning, I just want to make an appeal to your heart. Do we have? I've had to ask myself a lot of questions this week as I've been preparing this message. I've had to say to God, okay, I don't want to get up here on this platform and be preaching about disobedient hearts and have something in myself, something that you've told me to do and that I've missed it. So I'm saying, God, search me. Search me, oh God, and know my heart. Try me. Shine that spotlight on every dark corner. Is something got in the way of my fellowship with you? Have I lost a fellowship with your Holy Spirit and not even realized it? And I come to church every week thinking that everything's okay, and actually I've stepped backwards. And the Holy Spirit has stepped backwards from me. I've grieved the Holy Spirit. So I'm opening my heart to conviction. See if there is any disobedience in my heart. Is there something in my attitude? Have I grieved the Holy Spirit? Am I missing His presence? Have I allowed the culture to take the place of His presence? Have I allowed the fact that I'm comfortable in the culture to convince myself that everything's okay between me and God? Or am I placing my honor and my reputation above doing the right thing? Have I traded my relationship with God for what people think about me? Show me what I need to get back into your presence, God. And if you're feeling that there's something that God's speaking to you, I want to tell you that there's a way of restoration that is open to you right now. This is a moment under the conviction, under the spotlight of God, where you can say, yes, God, I ignored that, but I'm coming back. I'm here to be obedient. I'm here to say yes, Lord, to what I said no to before. I'm here to stop the compromise. I'm here to say I don't want to keep putting myself and my reputation first. I'm going to honor you, God, first. There is a way to restoration, and there are people here this morning, and you're going to come in to a new level of fellowship with the Holy Spirit. As you bring yourself into line with God, you're going to find that there is a sweet walk with the Holy Spirit that's going to come into your life. And you thought, I had forgotten about this. I've been missing this so much. David said in his prayer of repentance, when he'd been walking in disobedience and covered it up big time and kept up the culture, kept up the appearance, when the Spirit of God came upon him and the conviction was there to expose him, he said, God, do not take your Holy Spirit from me. And that was in effect a recognition that the Holy Spirit had been taken from him. And he was saying, bring it back, bring it back, bring the Holy Spirit back to me. I want that fellowship once again. I want, restore to me the joy of your salvation. Restore to me the peace of knowing that I am right with you. Restore to me the peace of knowing that I'm walking in obedience. And right across this building, if there's anybody that this is speaking to you, just as an acknowledgement to God, just raise your hand quickly and put it down again, that God's speaking to you. Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. There's no shame in this. There's no shame in this. Just saying, yeah, that's me. I need to put something right. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. All across the building. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Show me what I need to do to get back into your presence. Some of you know exactly what you need to do. It's just a matter of taking that step. We're going to sing now. We're going to close the service. But I don't want you to miss the moment. I don't want the culture to cover the moment. Let the Holy Spirit have his way in your life. This is a moment, this is an opportunity to come into close fellowship to your next level with God and with the Holy Spirit. Let's do that together as we sing.
Oh,
I just want to manage and steward this moment appropriately. So we're going to close the service now. The service is over. But I want to leave a space here for those who God has been speaking to you. The band are just going to continue playing. And if you want to just be here in the presence of the Lord, that's great. The rest of you, you're free. If you want to go out, if you want to chat, do that outside so that this space becomes a place of encounter for those that the Lord is meeting. The people who raise their hands to say they want to give their lives to God, to dedicate themselves to God, please come and see me at the front and we'll show you where you can go. For the rest of us, the service is done. God bless you. Thank you so much, church, for being here. Online church, thank you for being with us. God bless you. In Jesus' name. Spirit, you reign.
Salvation, renew right spirit.